Hi, welcome to our weekly Forex and Futures Forecast. My name is Jay Norris. I teach trading at Trading University. Before we get to the charts, I'm going to leave you with this very important piece of information. A market can retrace itself up to two-thirds and still maintain its primary pattern. That's straight out of Dow theory. I can't possibly overstate how important that tenet is to traders. As always, we need to remind you that trading involves risk of loss, and it's not suitable for all investors. First market we're going to take a look at would be the Australian dollar. Like we said, that two-thirds level, critical. Guess where the Australian dollar is right now? Two-thirds, right? Here, I'll draw the retracement for you. We're just taking the 09 low to the 2011 high, and you can see you're right at two-thirds. Well, what does that mean? That means that this pattern itself that was born in 2008 and ran its course through 2011, that pattern is still technically bullish because you haven't been able to close below that two-thirds level. So that's definitely going to be a level to watch in the Aussie. As we've been saying all along, hey, the Aussie has great demographics. The Australians, they're blessed with a lot of natural resources. They're essentially China's broker, who's going to be the big dog going forward for not just decades but centuries. We all know that's going to be China. So Australia's in a really good position. And sure, we were beating on it on the way down there. That's just how it is. We're traders, but longer term, we're not that bared up at all on the Aussie. In fact, we think this is going to be a longer term level to watch for support, and that eventually is going to lead to a potential rally going the other way, a trend shift. So we're definitely going to keep an eye on that. And back to that two-thirds level, that's a critical level, and we'll give you some examples of that along the way today. Next market, the Swiss franc. I'm on record saying, hey, if I liked it, if I thought we had a lot of room up here, I think we have even more room when you get down there. Swissies already retraced half of that big sell-off, and if you come to a daily chart, you can see that market stalling out there. At that 50% level, that's pretty normal. We think you'll see some consolidation, maybe even a little pullback there, but overall, when you look at the big picture, let's pan all the way out to a monthly. We think there's a whole lot of room on the upside in that market. There it is. You can see that massive bear market in the dollar Swiss as the Swiss franc strengthened against the dollar. We think that pattern has finally shifted here, and we think that's this low created by that massive intervention right there, that's the first higher low. You already have higher highs here now. Here's a higher high. There's your first higher low. So we think that's definitely a sea change move in favor of the U.S. dollar. So we like buying dips in the dollar Swiss. Next market, the dollar index. Dollar index, just a runaway rally. Just a monster of a move. Let's pan out to the monthly to get scope on it. There it is, and you can see, boy, there's still a lot of room on the upside. We think par is in the cards. We think the dollar index will get to 100 fairly easily. And if you go back to the last cyclical top right here, back in the early 2000s, and you can see that market was as high as 120. So, you know, why not? But, of course, it's got to get through 100 first to move on to those peaks. But when you put it in perspective, you're still a long ways from the top previous the previous cycle top, and really everything's coming up dollar. We anticipate a much stronger first quarter of 2015 to the first quarter in 2014, and I'll go on record as saying we think that second quarter, which you had a blowout second quarter in 2014, you're even going to eclipse that. You're going to do even more business in 2015. So the U.S. economy is on track to continue those gains. That's going to show up in the form of a continued strong dollar. Next market, the euro. I'm going to come back to that two-thirds rule, which I showed you was so important here. Let me clear these lines off of here first. Show you why two-thirds is so important to us. Let's take the euro here, for example, and we'll take the 2011 high, and we'll do a retracement from the 11 high to the 2012 low. And we'll draw that retracement, and as Dow said, a market can retrace up to two-thirds and maintain that pattern. And there it is again. Look at that perfect two-thirds retracement in 2014. It topped out right at 140. And what is so fascinating about these retracements are that everyone, even the journalists, even the company analysts, they all know what the fundamentals are. Everyone knew on the way up that you had bearish fundamentals in the euro, you continue to have bearish fundamentals, yet price went higher and higher and higher. Well, once it finally got to that two-thirds, basically once you squeezed out all those people with shorts and you stopped them out, then the market makers are in a good position to step back and then let that market do what it's going to do. And really, that's risk tolerance threshold theory. All the cards are on the table. Everybody knows the situation. Everyone knew the overwhelmingly bearish fundamentals in the euro, but price kept going higher. Well, why is that? Well, that's just how markets move. That's how it works, and that's how market makers do what they need to do to get back on the right side of things and make a lot of money and not lose money. It's very rare that the public, you'll see the public actually the ones making the money. And, you get involved in the realm of markets and market makers, and it's a tough racket. However, if you know to wait for those two-thirds levels, they're so important in markets. If you're patient and you could just sit back and let that market get all the way up to that two-thirds against all odds, against all the news and the papers and what the analysts are screaming, and you just be patient and let the market get to that two-thirds level, then you're in a good position as a trader. I would certainly tell you that, and really we demonstrate that week in, week out here. So euro, we still think there's plenty of room on the downside. If I said the dollar index is going to par, then I'd have to say, yeah, the euro is going to par also. The euro is at 113 right now. We think par is in the cards. You know, nothing goes straight up or straight down for sure. So you can see you're getting a little play here, and that's actually reflected in our day trade benchmark. Here you go. We had our first loser of the year in the euro there, day trade. One of the rules for our day trading is we don't trade ahead of central bank news. We don't trade ahead of employment news. You know, it was interesting. We had a loser in the euro earlier in the week, midweek. We could have got that right back on the U.S. employment number, but we got to stick to the plan. We don't trade in front of those numbers. The reason we don't trade in front of big numbers is we can't control our risk. Ideally, we don't want to risk more than you can afford to lose, correct? In fact, our profit objective is based on our risk. So you can't control your risk during an economic release. It's one thing if we say, hey, we're going to risk, 25 to 30 pips on a trade. That's well and good if there's no economic releases. But you can't get away with that if there's a number such as the U.S. employment number. You just don't know. I'll show you a 15-minute chart to make that point about risk. The market jumped, the euro jumped from 114.47 down to 113.80 in a hurry. So the market moved over 60 pips. You can't control your risk as a day trader if you're going to insist on trading through economic releases. So there's good and bad in that, right? But for us, we don't green light trades ahead of those economic releases. So we didn't have any trades Thursday into Friday. Next is the gold market. What did we say 2 weeks ago? If ever there's a time to take a short gold position using leverage, that was the time that we said that right here. And look what happened. That proved to be apropos, didn't it? Back to that two-thirds rule, Dow theory. I'm going to show you a cool example here. And this really should be an eye-opener for you. Hey, I totally get it that people don't believe what they hear until they're ready to believe it. But, the numbers don't lie. Markets don't lie. I told you about that two-thirds, right? So you take the all-time high in gold to the 2012 low and look at where gold topped out at. Boom. Right at two-thirds. So gold topped out right at two-thirds in October of 2012. That was the perfect trade right there, right? Look at that. Imagine if you went short gold there. Boy, that was a heck of a timing for that trade now, right? It was a great timing there. Let's come back to today, where we are now. And if you take the high in 2014 to the low in 2014, and you do that retracement, and you understand a market can retrace up to two-thirds, you know the power of that. There's two-thirds right there. And guess where Goldie topped out at? Right at two-thirds. So it is what it is. We're big, big believers that the pattern on the chart is absolutely a reflection of the underlying fundamentals in a market. And that's our belief system. Next market we'll cover will be the dollar-yen. Big up day in dollar-yen. And what have we been saying the last couple of weeks about the yen? We think, yeah, there's a possibility that the yen has topped out longer term. You got a lot of resistance up ahead, but that process can take a long time as you see first consolidation in the form of big, big swings and then eventually distribution. But we don't think you're at a distributive point just yet. We think you're in the process of working things out and going sideways. And along the way, you're going to have big up days and big down days in that process, and that's what you're seeing in dollar yen. And what happened on the big up day in dollar yen? You had a big down day for gold and the other currencies. So just because you're in the process of carving out a consolidatory period here for the yen, that doesn't mean that the dollar rally's over by any stretch. We'll cover a commodity. We'll cover interest rates, the last market here. I thought we covered this last week. We covered it extensively in classes, but we did not get to it in the report because I went back and looked. And here's the 10-year note, interest rates in the United States, right? Here's interest rates. And why do we have that sell zone there, that little box there? Well, you guys should be guessing where I'm going now. You take the all-time high at 2012 in interest rates, and you drop it down here in the 10-year note to the low of 2013, and guess where you're at? Two-thirds. So we feel pretty strongly that there's a possibility that this will be your first lower high in the 10-year notes. In other words, you're going to have potentially higher interest rates in the United States, and the Fed's been on record all along saying, yeah, we're going to raise interest rates, but it's going to be data dependent. And in fact, they said way back when they're probably going to do it in 2015. Guess what? You're in 2015. If you continue to see the GDP growth, the retail sales growth that we anticipate, then you're going to see higher rates in the United States. And you're looking at it right here, potentially the first lower high in a massive, massive rally in U.S. Treasury. So you're looking at the inflection point, that turn right there. Here it is on the weekly chart, big change of direction on the weekly chart. And here it is on the daily chart where you can really get scale there. And you can see why we're hyped up about using leverage to get short at that level. Tricky business, though, because if you went short here and you put a stop up above, guess what? They just barely stopped you out. Then they turned around. That's why you got to watch these guys on a closing basis. Got above that two-thirds, but it never could do it on a successive closes. So that's what you got to watch for. And that's why we put a disclaimer on it. You know, it's not rocket science, but at the same time, it is risk. All right. My name is Jay Norris. Good to see you. Thanks for attending. I do teach trading at Trading University, and we'll leave you with these words of wisdom from Robert Ray's book, The Dow Theory.